on my show several times. So I interview, like, I've done over 150 birdie crack candidates. Sherelle Connor comes back a lot, things like that, and also activists and such.
Brad Zim, I'm with Real Progressives. I do occasional IT work. I write, edit, help build a website, do all kinds of fun stuff at IT.
Awesome. Will Beeman, I'm from Boston, and I'm here with Modern Money Network.
Cool.
I'm Sherry Wise, I'm an economist with federal government. I'm so under from the DC.
And
I'm Gisela Lopez, I'm from Chile. I'm a lawyer, so I'm going to.
I'm a lawyer too, so.
Okay.
And you're a lawyer?
Nick Estes, I'm a retired lawyer from Albuquerque.
See, we're here. Okay. Okay.
Two minutes, okay. What are the different actors in the financial side of the economy and how important are they? So I started looking at that a little bit more detail to try to understand the role of the household, because, you know, the household, there's not that many people, or there's not, it doesn't have an organized group of people fighting for it. So I figured my role as an academic would be to support the many people, and so that's one of the reasons I'm interested in seeing what the household is doing and how they're doing. So if you look at the households with respect to the entire financial landscape, the financial landscape is divided into three main branches. So we see the private sector, the government sector, and then the rest of the world sector. Each of these sectors comprises different proportions of the entire financial landscape. So if we look, the private sector accounts for about 42%, and this is over time for the last, I think, 60 years of data. Government sector is about 43%. And the rest of the world sector comprises about 15% of the total financial world. Now, if we look at the private sector, we divide the private sector into households and businesses. So households make up about 30% of the total financial landscape, and businesses comprise about 12% of the total financial landscape. So what this brings to our attention is that households are a really important player when it comes to all of what's going on in finance. So if the household is suffering, then the entire financial sector could have problems. So we really do want to know what is happening at the level of the household. Are there hardships experienced there? What kind of hardships? So that we can understand how to stabilize the economy from the perspective of the household. So I've made a couple of pie charts for us. So here with these pie charts, you really get a feeling for, this is an expression of the entire financial sector of the economy. And the private sector comprises 42%, the government sector 43%, and then the rest of the world, which is all the other countries relative to the US in this case, is about 15%. So you really can see. Now we're going to break down that private sector to see households and businesses and how they are part of the entire landscape. So here we see the government sector still at 43, the rest of the world sector is 15. And we break down the private sector into its two major components, which are businesses and households. Businesses comprise 12% of the entire sector, and households actually represent 30% of all financial transactions that take place. So this just kind of hits home the point that households' well-being really means the well-being of the entire economy. So really it's important to study what is happening at the level of the household. Here what I've done is I'm expressing the financial sector balances. The financial sector balances show that the private sector balance is a direct reflection of what's happening in the government sector. So here you see the different financial sector balances. The private sector over time is in the light blue line. The navy line represents the government sector, and the green line represents the rest of the world sector. So if you look at the green line, this is what we buy from others. Okay? So you notice that what we buy from others has been increasing over time. Okay? Now if we do away with that green line, so pretend that the green line is not there, then it would mean that we buy from others exactly the same amount as they buy from us. So that would mean we buy exactly from others exactly what they buy from us. So we would have what we call a balanced external account. Okay? So pretend that the green line is not there. Do you see a pattern of behavior between the navy blue line and the light blue line? Right. So you see right away that they're almost mirror images of one another. They are. If you didn't have any external sector balance, right? If we bought exactly from others exactly what they buy from us, then we would have a perfect mirror image, which just comes back to hit home this point that everything the government, these are government deficits here, government deficits end up in the hands of the private sector. So larger government deficits are reflected in larger private sector balances and surpluses. So this is, now I want to know, if the private sector has these beautiful, you know, surpluses, where are the surpluses? Are they in the hands of businesses? Are they in the hands of households? I want to know, right? So I'm breaking it down. Here I can see we have households with the dark line, and then businesses with the light blue line. So you'll see that businesses' normal pattern of behavior is that they would be indebted. There was a change here, right? They went into surplus, but then they went back into kind of a more indebted position. And that's a normal position for businesses, because when you're undertaking a business transaction or an endeavor, what you're going to do is you're going to indebt yourself in order to produce a good or service. So naturally, it's normal for businesses to be in debt as a sector as a whole. And normal situation is for households to have a surplus. So you notice that here they had a surplus for the longest period of time, and in 1998, they go into deficit, and they stay into deficit, which is super problematic, right? But then we had a huge discussion, those of us who are working in the financial sector balances, they're like, this big discussion, why are household indebtedness is so high? They're supporting private sector balances, like the private sector business surpluses, this is a problem, etc. And then now we look at here, since 2006, in the financial crisis, we see that households have major, major surpluses. So all of a sudden we have this position where households actually have surpluses, but I look around myself and I don't see those surpluses in the hands of my neighbors and myself. I don't, right? If households had big, big surpluses, whose households I have that? I'm not getting any of that, and I don't see it around me, right? So I'm trying to understand what's really going on there. How is it possible that the data that is expressed is coming out of the reality I experience, and it's not, like, it doesn't feel right. Okay, so I kind of like dig a little deeper. And we're trying to explain that. So the main findings, and this is, I just wanted to kind of like start introducing the financial sector balances. Some of you probably already know a lot about it, but I wanted for this audience to kind of just make it real general, because we're people coming from all sorts of different walks of life and different kind of areas. So households are a significant element in the financial landscape. They constitute about 30% of the total net lending or net surplus of the financial sector. The government deficits offset surpluses in the private sector and the rest of the world sector. Regarding the private sector, government deficits can offset both household and business surpluses. The normal position is for government deficits to offset surpluses, but business and well-maintained business maintains a deficit position. Since 2007, the households have had a net surplus. Since 2015, both households and businesses have surpluses. So we seek to understand those issues, why those are coming up. So why is it that both households and businesses have surpluses? Do we have any ideas, ways to explain that? How is it possible that a business is able to maintain a surplus while still indebting itself to produce? What is it producing? Like, what is it actually making in the economy that allows businesses to maintain a surplus while producing something?
You're asking us?
No, I want you to like think about that question. Mainly it's just to think about it, and maybe after during the discussion we can talk about it, because for me, I have some ideas about what might be happening there, okay? And you may have some different ideas, so together we can work on that. And then another question that comes up as a result of this expression is to say, what household buying that allows their net worth to stay so positive? What happens if the value of homes fall, like we saw during the financial crisis? What happens if they can't make payments on their mortgages or their home equity lines of credit? So what is it that the households are buying that is allowing them to maintain a net surplus position? Okay. And then we can ask ourselves, what households are benefiting from the surplus, right? I mean, this is something super relevant for us here. What about the households that need support? And then what kind of supports would help all households broadly? And I think that a lot of the things that we talk about here at the MMT conference and in MMT circles, like universal childcare, like job guarantee, like greening up the economy, those kind of things really help everyday households that are working in that non-surplus position, you know, within the overall surplus position. So those are some of the questions that we are working on right now, and I wanted to just kind of open it up now and share this information with you, and then maybe you can, like, you know, if you have any questions, I'll take them now.
I got a question. Yeah. What do you mean by surplus in this sense? What do you mean by balance? What do you mean by balance? Are you really talking about a change in balances? You're talking more about income or net income rather than the actual total amount of money that all households have. Do you follow what I'm saying? Are we talking about a change in net position, or are we talking about the net position itself? I think we're talking about change.
So the net lending position is assets minus liabilities of households, assets minus liabilities of private sector actors like businesses, and those include financial businesses and non-financial businesses. So it's actually the net worth of these different sectors. Net lending minus net borrowing. Lending minus borrowing.
I guess I'm confused about whether you're talking about income. Are you talking about flows or stocks?
So I'm looking at, this is a stock flow consistent macro model, which means that I account for the flows as they establish them as stocks. So I look at income flow, and I look at the end result, the stock, and over time how that stock changes as a result of new flow changes. So this is an expression of stocks as they change over time as a result of changes in flows. Okay?
Okay. Hey, so you showed the graph with three balances, and you were noting that the private sector and government sector, excluding the foreign sector, tend to be pretty well correlated. So I feel like the policy implication there is that maybe we should run bigger deficits to create private surpluses. And so I'm kind of what, like, just, you know, feel this out. Like, I feel like that's subject to a Luker's critique kind of position, where you start trying to exploit that correlation to improve private financial sector positions, and maybe it breaks down. So any response?
Yeah, I mean, there's certainly an argument. Like, first of all, right now, you know, everybody's argued that, oh, we need larger government deficits in order to create larger private sector or to offset private sector surpluses, right? Or the offset private sector surpluses. So we actually have major deficits offsetting private sector surpluses right now. So that's like, if you were not living this reality, you'd see that and be like, man, we're just awesome right now. Things are great. But our lived reality is really, like, inconsistent with that. So that's kind of a problem right there. But regarding specifically what you're saying is, like, right now the business sector is certainly probably taking advantage to a certain extent, but if it was acting in coordination with one another, if they were acting as a corporate actor, if houses could act as a corporate actor, certainly they might take advantage of this kind of position. But you have major, like, disparities between different households in different groups, in different income groups. So they're not, I don't think that they could take advantage of the fact that the government sector deficits would be offsetting their surpluses. I don't even think they're thinking in that term at all.
Is there data that can tell us what the flow is between business sectors and household sectors?
Right. To look at the flow between business sector and household sector, well, here's the thing, that business sector is separate from the household sector in this model, but many businesses and households have flows between them, income flows between them. So because of the stock flow consistency of this model, you're going to see a flow of income coming into the household, whether it comes from a business or it comes from a household, that flow of income would be established as a piece of the household stock.
I'm not an economist, maybe I'm saying something very wrong, but maybe the surplus is the it's because families are only paying debt. So maybe they are decreasing the total amount of the debt of the households, and so that represents maybe, I don't know, a great number, but they are only paying the debt.
Yeah. Well, that's exactly right. So even though you're not an economist, you see that in your everyday reality, and we actually see that expressed in that data too. It's like households indebt themselves to their house. They buy the house, so their main assets are generally houses, along with some retirement portfolio, whatever. So you have the house as your main asset, and then the house, you start paying it down a little bit, but then you're like, oh, but life is hard, and prices are increasing, etc. And I want more. So then you take equity out of your home through a home equity line of credit, and the house is appreciating in value. Therefore, your net worth is increasing even as your debt levels, your liabilities are increasing, and you might be, you know, finding this additional consumption using credit. And that, we definitely see that, at least in middle income families, we see that a lot.
Yeah, this brings up two things for me. The first thing is, I mean, since the financial crisis, everyone's like a renter now. So no one actually owns their house anymore. I mean, like, if you look at the United States, like, you know, like, I think it's over 50% are now renters since 2008. In a lot of cities, it's up to 65-70% of people are renters. When in 2008, it was like actually less than half the people were renters. So, you know, obviously it's a big transfer of wealth. So that's one thing, is that people don't actually own anything. They don't own any capital. And it's being hoarded in the financial sector. I mean, you have trillions of dollars in the financial sector that are just sitting there. I think that's reflected in this graph. I mean, I think Bloomberg just said there's like $13 trillion in the global economy that's like negative interest, like now, like, which is like historical. So I'm just wondering, how do they hoard those trillions of dollars? And maybe, yeah, I mean, obviously, you need to have deficits to fund social programs and new transformative programs, but if there's already deficits, you know, like this graph says, right? So there's enough money in the economy, right? It's like, how do you extract it from the elite, basically, right? And then bring it back down to the household level.
Okay, well, there's a couple things that you brought up. So the first one is that, you know, how do we, that many people are now renters, et cetera, and this is a problem. So in this presentation, you don't see that, right? You don't see that a huge percentage of the population are now renters. What you see, though, you do see a positive net worth for households. So then what you want to do from here is break that down in order to get to that result, right? You break down, what are the households here that have this huge surplus? Because the businesses don't actually have these major surpluses. So there's, maybe here we have a little bit of some surpluses overall, but they are basically in a net deficit position relative to households. So that means that even though businesses might be sitting on like $1 billion, of assets, they're also sitting on $2 billion of debt or liabilities that they undertook in order to buy that rental property, buy that, you know, building, commercial building space, to be able to rent it to people over time. So there's different players in the economy, right? Different ways to handle yourself within that economy. But what we see is, yeah, there are big surpluses that are held by the private sector, but they're offset by really large liabilities as well. So how do we extract from the rich and bring to regular everyday people? Well, we have to say, like, what is it that's really hampering the household and their everyday existence? Why are households indebting themselves? And I think that's the main question that I'm finding always coming back to. So the big reasons that households indebt themselves is for medical expenses, education, childcare. Those are the big ones. So that being said, if you really understand that, you provide universal childcare, education, and, you know, jobs. So those kind of things can really help out, right? An everyday person that's a renter might be able to start saving. They're not always like working in debt. So I think that's really the key to like creating a society of equal opportunity and social mobility.
I guess that household sector runs a surplus because since the financial crisis, we have this very low interest rate environment, and somehow this kind of low interest environment drives people to save more instead of, you know, because now we have like 2% of saving instead of maybe 1% of saving before financial crisis. And because of that, you know, when the central banks, they cut interest rate, they think, oh, people will go out and consume more because low interest rate will borrow from their credit card or take out their mortgage loans, so they can buy a home because the interest rate is low. But actually, it's the opposite because, you know, interest rate is low, so somehow the fixed income they can consume what they can, you know, use is further limited. So that's why people save more in order to, I mean, instead of consuming more, this kind of behavior psychologically driver instead of, you know, this policy assumption. That's my guess.
Yeah. We actually, thank you for your question. We actually don't see increased savings as a result of, as the outcome of just saving from income. What we see is people paying down debt, and when lower interest rates prevail, people pay down debt. That may be the case, but they also increase amounts of debt at these lower rates of interest by drawing on equity that they have in their home or taking out other kinds of debt. And so what they're doing is increasing their net asset position by undertaking a higher level of liabilities. So what you will do is, let's say the debt that you have is the length of the table, you will increase the length of your debt, but the value of your home, which offsets that debt, will have increased over time, so that the difference between the asset and the liability increases, and that's a net saving. So net saving appears to increase as a result of people just having their income and putting it aside, but it's not increasing for that reason. It's increasing because this is the net asset. The net liability becomes smaller relative to the value of the net asset. The difference between the net asset and the net liability is going to be counted as saving in the stock flow accounting matrix. I'm pretty sure. And there's another thing about that relationship, which I'm not even sure exactly how to express, but ways that we pay down debt and how they get counted in the balance and the national income and product accounts, that's another element which can trick us into thinking that people are saving from their income when in fact they're doing something else. Yeah.
Yeah. I'm wondering if we can, this makes me think about, you know, disaggregating the household sector to show, you know, people who are on different sides of, you know, renters and landlords, you know, for instance, because, you know, in an economy where everyone's a renter, it doesn't necessarily mean that the household is, you know, net, the household sector is like net losing assets or something. You know, it's just a transfer within the household sector. And so it seems like there must be, you know, a stratification within the sector that would be part of an explanation for this kind of thing. I was wondering your thoughts on that.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I did break that down in a paper a few years ago. And if you break down what's going on in the households, you'll see, you know, you have the what we've been talking about for many years now, for the last 10 years now, is you have the top 10% of households who are really benefiting a great deal from economic expansion, and then you have the bottom 90% who might be struggling. Some of them benefit from expansion during some 3-year period, and some of them actually suffer from the expansion or don't benefit from the expansion over the 3-year periods that you see. And so, yeah, there's definitely, you know, some houses that are benefiting and some houses that are not benefiting. You have more renters, but they're not benefiting, you know, so.
Joel, do you have any last comments?
No, thank you very much.
Thanks. Well, everyone give her a round of applause to Joel. Now we have Gisela Lopez, and she comes from all the way from Chile to explain the legal concept of money. And that's actually really interesting because people are used to thinking of money as, like, I don't know, bars of gold or whatever. And we've gotten her presentation. So please welcome Gisela Lopez.
Wanted to be discussed in the event and established that one of the key orientation points of the conference would be to answer the following question. Could the institution of money function without state support? I submitted a paper that proposes the defense of the opposite idea, but it was not selected. Nevertheless, the aim of that conference is not an isolated idea. Rather, it is a new way of thinking about money in our social and economic monetary circles. In my opinion, the rebirth of this idea is a collateral effect of the eruption of the cryptocurrencies. Based on this new phenomenon, people feel authorized to think in the utopian idea that money could exist without a state, because the mere existence of these e-currencies show us that the monetary system may exist and function only by the collective use. This seductive idea is only an illusion, in my opinion. In England words, the end of money, futurology, is no more than a redescription of the 1970 liberal misunderstanding of their monetary system and implicitly a repetition of their vain hope of a world without politics. My strong answer to this question is not just that money cannot function without state support, rather, money cannot function without a state. The difference between both propositions lies in the fact that the second one excludes a non-support to express the radical view that I endorse, that is, that the legal concept of money and debt cannot be offered without imagining the existence of the state or any authority with the same ontological properties. So the idea that I want to present today is compromised with the assumption that money is a creator of law, as not declared in 1905. The function of the state in the monetary system, rather than be a mere support of identified with the creation of the necessary conditions that enable the existence of the monetary system. I call this condition the state-based conditions that consist first in the state declaration of which will be the unit of account, and second, the declaration of what comes as money, valuta, or accessory inside the territory. The state-based conditions are necessary but not sufficient. I propose that the first condition interacts with what I call the social-based conditions, that consists in the recognition of the mentioned state declarations by the community through the actual use of a token of some social artifact that exceeds the monetary status function assigned with collective intentionality by a community, imposing and recognizing some artifact type as a special status function in John Searle terms. That means that money cannot perform its monetary status function solely in virtue of the physical structure. In simple, in order to incorporate into some community the social artifact called money, the physical structure of money is irrelevant. The state declarations and the social use and recognition of some tokens money by a community are the necessary and sufficient conditions of existence of a monetary system. The Chartres theory, as a procedure of the MMT, has the virtue of understanding how money works in some community and to develop not just an economic theory, but a legal theory of money too. The brilliantness of Knapp was his capacity to see the monetary phenomenon detached from the physical condition, a physical condition that was supposed by all in his time as the essence of money. Even so, Knapp could not have imagined that during the 70s, the declaration of President Nixon would give him his point. In the first part of this presentation, I will indicate some summary ideas regarding the nature of money. And the second part, the main one, I will explain the biggest contribution of the Chartres view to offer a legal concept of a monetary system. Money as an institutional artifact is not intelligible, isolated. A very complex piece of money as an institutional artifact is not intelligible, isolated. As a very complex piece, it is part of a picture composed by other elements that are inserted within, by the declaration of rules, practices, and conventions that construct a social reality. In this way, my strategy of reconceptualization of money takes me to introduce and define a more complex structure that can be described as a monetary system. From the specialized literature, it is possible to note that we are affected by an image, money, that does not let us thinking in Wittgenstein words. A picture, as he said, held us captive, and we couldn't get outside of it for it lay in our language, and language seemed only to repeat it to us inexorably. That means that we try to construct a theory of money in spite of constructing a theory of monetary system at all, because the term money is a picture that held us captive. Thinking in terms of monetary system allows us to explain in better terms our economical and political relationships. Please note that Lab has the virtue of considering money not as a central idea. First, he separated the concept coin and money, and then he analyzed money as a means of payment. Knapp was not committed with the money as the object of his study. In his own words, the structure of our economy, which we like to designate a money economy, does not depend on money. It only appears to depend on it because we almost make our payment by transfer of money. But that is only a special case. The essential feature of obligations measures in the unit of value. In the same line, you can see Randall Ray's book. A brief philosophical approach to the ontology of money. Money can be explained as a social phenomenon. Using Jung's seminal contribution, money is a social institution, which means that it's an entity that has the property to exhibit a codified status function imposed by humans acting with collective intentionality. Such collective intentionality can be explained with similar words to observe. The totality of these norms and facts has validity only concerning specific physiological organizations. Complementing this point with the tools offered by the artifact theory, money exceeds the ontology of an institutional law artifact, in which by artifact we must understand a tool that intentionally signals or communicates that it's a tool. So the agent can notice the specific property related to the achievement of some goals that the artifact exceeds. Again, in similar words, a visible object, money, is a substance that embodies abstract economic value in a similar fashion to the sound of words, which in a caustic physiological occurrence, but has significance for us only through the representation that it bears or symbolizes. The goals that money must achieve and communicate as an artifact are related to the possibility to pay debt that were undertaken by the agent in the interchange process and goods and services or were imposed by the state, such as taxes. However, the common characteristic in both cases is that money achieves the status function in a non-affective manner. This property of money is carried out through the biontic power, that is rights, duties, responsibility, immunity, etc., that are attached to the money institutional artifact, granted or imposed in the use of money. Money as an artifact makes the payment and interchange an abstract operation. Now, in the second part of this presentation, I want to explain three contributions of the chartalism to the monetary system. After the summary of a philosophical characterization of the nature of money, the second part of my presentation will offer a defense of the idea that the ontological characterization of money must be understood along with the idea that the state is a protagonist and not a mere supporter of the monetary system. This idea represents the core of a Chartist view of money, and for me it is possible to identify three sub-essential concepts that would help the jurisprudence to understand and reconstruct a legal theory of the monetary system. One, the idea of money as a cartel piece and the derivative concept of valuta money. Two, the idea of the unit of account. And three, the macro idea of the payment system that contains the subsystem of kinds of payment, ultimately, chartal, general payments, and it is possible thanks to the existence of a pay society that needs a central clearing office to control and manage the operation that had and will take place inside it. First, the chartal pieces. Two functions of the so-called, what I call, monetary dimensions can be distinguished. On one hand, the monetary dimensions performs the concrete status function consisting of the payment of debt through instance of tokens of money, paper money, and coins. On the other hand, the monetary dimension executes the abstract status function consisting in the ability of the system to express value with a common standard of value called unit of account. That allows us to formulate promises to pay in the future, named debt, or to set up in the common value of things and services, called pricing. In the performing of the contract satisfaction, the monetary system imposes the form in which payment should be done, establishing that some pieces, called charter pieces, serve as a means of payment by the delivery of such tokens that realize the discharge of debt, in turn, in Keynes terms. In this sense, discharge can be identified with continental concept of payment in a wide sense. In Napman terms, the charter pieces are means of payment that have legal validity, neither because they are made by some material, neither because they are declared legal tender, nor because of the state issue them. They are valid because of acts of parliament or because the operation of other sources of law, administrative rules, set up that such and such pieces will have legal significance for the epicentric payment. In that sense, charter list rests on a certain relation to the law, according to a proclamation act that makes such and such pieces gain their validity. One sign that allows us to recognize that money is a charter means of payment is that the use of it grants the holder only circulatory satisfaction, in contrast with the real satisfaction like the pincetary means of payment grant. Charter piece is a piece legally stripped by the virtue of law of any material content. But what defines something as money inside a monetary sovereign territory is its acceptance as means of payment in the state office. That acceptance in payment, called epicentric by NAP, is the key concept of not only the use of it by a community. According to NAP, this acceptance is the consequence of the legal duty of the citizen to accept in apocentric payments the thing that the state has previously declared as accepted money. However, the acceptance and duty indicated have a secondary effect, the use of such tokens in paracentric payments. From the point of view of legal theory, it's possible to explain that circumstance with the help of three concepts: the granting of reasons, the deontic powers, and the self-certifying function of the law. The tax duty gives the payers the legal necessity to obtain such tokens. A clever state knows that it must put such tokens in circulation. So what does the state do? It buys things and obtains services from its citizens, paying them with the valuta money and forces them to receive valuta money in apocentric payments. On the other hand, the promise of the state to receive such tokens or means of payment from the taxpayer as a valid and definitive payment outlines the deontic power conferred to the holder of valuta money. These facts and the deontic power give the citizen reasons to obtain these tokens and as a consequence to use them in paracentric payments. Using the legal term minted by Shapiro, according to Kant theory, the monetary system as a subsystem of the law system is a self-certifying planning organization. That means that it's free to enforce its rules without first demonstrating to a superior, if one exists, that its rules are valid. According to it, the monetary system has the power to declare that some charter pieces are valuta money, creating eoipso, a general tool. The pieces enjoy a general presumption of validity. Like the Neil McCormick theory, they are institutive rules. That means rules that make explicit that what comes as money within a community, also establishing legal officers that put in force the monetary plan. In Peacock words, the state not only insisted that the taxes be paid in coin, it also guaranteed to accept coins as a minimum payment of tax payment. When transacting, subjects merely had to identify coin as a genuine state-issued coin to be sure if it is validity. From a concept of money as a declaratory means of payment that is instantiated in token money, it is possible to reconstruct the property rules regarding the mode of acquisition, transfer, and mode of loss the ownership of money. Properly speaking, the ownership of money is indeed ownership of chattels or mobile objects, personal property, however subjected to special rules. Therefore, it is a mistake to observe such rules as a legal anomaly. Rather, they are created to shape the monetary status function. For example, It would be correct to assume that the ownership of the toe of the money something is acquired by the holder just by the holding of them. In continental legal terms, the mode of acquisition of instance of coins and paper money would be characterized as an original mode of acquisition and not a derivative one. That implies that it has no relevance if the giver of the money has the ownership of coins and paper money or not, or if the acquisition has been fair or not by the acceptance. All these problems are problems, in my opinion, of the law of obligation and not of the law of the property. The second concept is the unit of account. The money, the unit of account, is a quantifier under which money, as a master of the planning terminology, can perform the abstract status function. The formulation of sums of money and the abstract function of the monetary system enables us to express, one, the value of things and services, namely price, and most important, the obligations to pay sum of money in the future, namely debt. According to the logic, the unit of account is a quantifier, so it does not represent any physical, real or material thing or value. It is just an arbitrary choice of the state by legal rules that count as declarations that compose the name-based, state-based condition. The money of account is a tool that allows us to participate in the monetary game, allowing us to express the value entities, and in that sense, it is fixed by a declarative rule with the authority of the state, but with the use of the community in the instance of each transaction. Paraphrasing Wittgenstein, as a color sample or the standard measure in Paris, the money of account is an instrument of the monetary language game by means of which we make monetary statement. And in this game, money of account is not something that is represented, but is a mean of representation. So according to the monetary grammar, we need to express value, and the tool is the unit of account. We only can recognize something with monetary properties when that entity may express some value, and that expression is possible by the operation under a quantifier named monetary unit of account. As Wittgenstein again said, the rules of grammar are arbitrary in the same sense as the choice of a unit of measurement. What that means for the monetary theory is that the arbitrary choice is made by the state, granting a general tool, and we can see that the members of the community follow the rule when they use or put in practice instance of money in paracentric payment. However, no idea that each pay society may establish its own monetary account is correct. Please note that the state is the unique institution in our society that's able to determine and modify the piece of money and the monetary unit in general terms, because it is the biggest pay society. The significance that can be said as similar observed, the significance of money as expressed in the relative value of commodity is, according to our early discussion, quite independent of any intrinsic value. Just as it's relevant whether a scale or measure pay consists of iron, wood, or glass, since the only relation of its part to each other or another measure concern us. So the scale that money provides for the determination of value has nothing to do with the nature of its substance. According to this idea, I disagree, at least in legal terms, with part of the Keynesian concept of money of account. Keynes noted that the money of account is the description or title. In my opinion, rather than be a description, the money of account is the mean of representation, the accounting element or the grammar tool, the quantifier, that allow us to express value by the formulation of sums of money, making the existence of debt possible and the comparison of goods and services to interchange them. If the payment is with cash, the interchange is an instant operation and it would be finished at that moment. However, the monetary system has created an additional tool, the debt, that makes possible that the final payment could be suspended in the time by the virtue of a formulation of an obligation were between the counterparty or some party and a third party, for example, the issuer of a credit card, according to highly complex legal relationships. I call this complex organization the game of the monetary debt and interchange, using Wittgenstein's terms. Furthermore, I disagree with Aglietta's idea that money essential function is to establish the unit of account. That function is not a money function, and neither is its essential function. The monetary system must be understood as a system, specifically a legal system, whose rules coordinate all its members, agents, material, non-material things, executory payment, and so on. One of the functions of the monetary system is to establish a specific monetary unit of account by the legal power of the state. We can understand this idea again by understanding the self-certifying function of the legal system. In that sense, the state declaration of the unit of account creates eo ipso, a general tool of payment. The abstract status function is to express the value that in Aglietta term is the abstract space of measurement in which the diverse activity takes place within a group, a human group, that can be exchanging things. In other words, it's the signifier of commodity values, allowing goods that are incomparable in qualitative terms to be designated in terms of identical units. On the other side, the abstract status function of the monetary system unit of account makes it possible that the interchange can be immediately, even though the buyers do not have the money token at that time. That can be possible thanks to the social legitimated system of debt. In grammar terms, money and debt appear on the scene at exactly the same time. One of the biggest contributions of the Chartist theory is to make possible the relevance of debt in monetary system and observing that there are always nominal. The nominalism of the money of account communicates nominalism to the debt. A nominal debt, as the opposite of a real debt, is in Lacan terminology a liquid debt. That means the object or content of debt is a sum of money. So it is possible to understand why the debtor is authorized by law to pay in chattel pieces or other eccentric authorized means of payment that will be valid at the time of the discharge of the debt, being irrelevant which was the valid means of payment at the time of the promise. Now let me offer a legal concept of a monetary obligation or debt in the common law terminology. A debt is an obligation that has been expressed by the parties or the states or the state in a sum of monetary unit of account valid in a monetary space. In neuro-legal terms, an obligation will be debt when it expresses a sum of value of money that is a positive real number under the value name of account. The consequence of assuming this concept is that the debt expressed under an index-linked unit or obligation that expressed just values as the obligation to indemnify losses in tort law could not count as debt in Hoffman, could not count as debt or monetary obligation. They could be described as duty or cases of responsibility in Hoffman terms. Please note that in both cases, a subsequent liquidation operation must be done by the parties or by the judge. In contrast, such kind of action is not necessary when we are in front of a debt. A debt is always ready to be paid. The payment system is the third concept. The third catalyst contribution is the reconstruction of a payment system in order to understand it is necessary to come with the following sub-concepts: means of payment, specifically chargal and jargal, a pay society, and a central clearing office. Now describe the payment as a legal proceeding, a legal method, and an administrative phenomenon that needs to introduce the unit of account concept, as it has been explained. As Knapp says, the payment system could function without the money, but not without the unit of value, because its object is a transfer of units of value. Inside the general monetary means of payment, it is possible to distinguish three systems of kind of payments. Automatism, where the notion of money has not been yet reached. Chargal payment, payment in money in tokens of different money type, and general payment, payment without money, transfer or credit from the one depositor to other. I will focus on the last one, the last two. To understand the gyro payment, it is necessary to introduce the concept of a pay society. The fact of its existence explains why the monetary system is an institutional artifact. The biggest pay society is the state society, integrated by the state, its officers, central bank, commercial bank, international institution, World Bank, FMI, and people, taxpayer and others, who receive apocentric payments. Not recognizing that at the same time, other pay society, let's think in private commercial banks. Nowadays, retailer groups as Amazon, as Facebook, credit card issuer institutions, and financial institutions. All of them are in relation with the common and particular legal rules that put them together in practice, shaping a monetary system. The big picture of all monetary agents inside some sovereign territory may be expressed as follows. Private pay society functions with the state, hence they are inside the pay society, the state pay society, so need to use the state unit of account, making egocentric and participating in apocentric payments, fixing their credit cards, their credit, sorry, and debts, accounts, and payments in the unit of account named by the state. Considering that each pay society must have administrative guidance, there must be authorities with legal powers to fix the nature and manner of the payment. It must have a center from which it's managed. So I will introduce the NAP concept, Central Clearing Office, which will serve to formulate a concept of payment, a legal method coordinated by an authority with legal powers that consists in the legal transfer of claims and counterclaims in units of value directed to the central office. If the payment is a charge in kind, the central office should accept pieces, that means things, constituting payment as a legal transfer of such pieces. However, in gyro system, the payment is made only by book entries, by the order named by member A that delivers a claim which stands to discredit at the central office in member in favor, sorry, to the member B. The creditor holds a claim to the central office, which only arises in such event when the central office makes a claim on him as a counterclaim, which he brings to light by the delivery of definitive means of payment for the purpose of discharging his debt. The corollary of this idea in ideas in relation to private law is that the debt has the virtue of being able to discharge by any kind of payment system. So it may be paid in money or not. Insofar, it is wrong to say that the debt is an obligation that must be paid in money. Being the object of the debt a sum of money, there is no preference between one of them. As Bolt said in German in the 1970s, who pays with a non-check does not offer to pay with substitute object. It is not a discharge in agreement in common law terms. When you pay with a check, just pay or discharge by performance. Thank you.
So we are running a bit behind on time. So in the interest of that, we're going to keep questions kind of short, but we'll take just a few. You should get the first one.
Well, I just wanted to clarify. For the audience, would you mind clarifying the difference between the medalist view of money and the, like, what is the medalist view of money? Because you mentioned chargeless, so we can compare.
The medalist view is the opposite idea of a chargeless view, and they support the idea that money has value because it is a commodity.
And the chargeless view is that it is a creation by the state and with legal parameters.
As Nat said, money has not a value, it has validity. So it is the difference. The money is a piece, a charter piece that is by the care of the state, a common means of payment.
And do you know, in throughout history, the states have always had a monopoly on money creation, right?
According to NAP idea and Simon and so on, the money always can change, the state, sorry, always can change the unit of account, and that can show us that the money of account is the essential concept of a monetary system. So it is not important to understand the payment as the delivery of a thing. That is the classic view in the legal theory. Everybody minds that when you pay, when you have a debt, you must pay something as a thing. So they are real debts, not a liquid debt, as Nav said.
Thank you so much.
Other questions?
So I noticed that you were knocking on that Gayatella and Keynes in one of your slides there. If you can go back to it, you were saying that money is essential function is to establish the unit of account,
yes.
And you're saying this is the function of the monetary system. Mm-hmm. And then also that you said that for Keynes, the unit of account, or is it money, is a description or title, and you're saying no, it's an accounting element or a mean representation. Could you just give us a little bit more detail on that?
Yes.
Because it's kind of controversial.
Yes. A philosopher named Quine, he made a classification of the nouns as mass term and non-mass term. And for example, water is a mass term. You don't can say one water. You always need to say, to refer to water as a number, a quantifier. A number or another tool. In the monetary system, the tool to express the value, to express the debt, to express the price, is a money of account. So the money doesn't create the unit of account. The system, in the whole picture, has one element that is the unit of account, and that unit of account allows us to express with a real positive number, like one or two, and the unit of account, the dollar, for example, $1, that can express, can allow us to express value and prices and debt. So it is not the function of the money, it's the function of the system.
That's very good.
Yeah. It's like a terminology precision, right?
No, but it's good.
I'll just follow up on that. So what was Keynes trying to say? What is the description or title? What is it?
Keynes was a follower from Nav. He knows the German version of his book, The State Theory of Money. And someone has the theory that Keynes helped to translate the book from German to English. So it is a proof that Keynes has the book of Nav to see and to study. And from then he recognized that Nav has the virtue to understand two different things. The monetary tokens, so that Keynes called them the money token, and a different thing is the money, is the unit of account. So the unit of account is the He made this definition, the description or title. And the token money is what can be realized this description. In my opinion, that is not a correct view, because the money of account is only an instrument, a tool. It is not a description. It's not a proposition in language terms. It's just a tool to express or to formulate a proposition. We cannot formulate dates, we cannot formulate the price of the thing if we don't have the unit of account. So the for example, the price is the sum of money that it is formulated under a quantifier that is the unit of account.
Okay, we're gonna cut that off there. Thank you very much. We can give her a round of applause.
Thank you.
Professor Gisela Lopez's presentation was very, as a lawyer, very interesting to me because it's actually kind of, it's very different from the concept of money that you hear on popular media all the time. And yes, and so, but it's also, and from her presentation, you understand that the idea of money or monetary policy is not a neutral. There is a value judgment, there is a morality, there are winners and losers that the government picks with their monetary policy. So our next presentation is actually going to be related with this. We are having Dr. Miguel Ahmed Sanchez, a professor of constitutional law from the Facultad de Derecho in Granada, Spain. And he will be talking about the constitutional function of money, which is actually very, it dovetails well with Professor Gisela Lopez's theory of money and charterism. So please give him a warm welcome.
But first of all, I'm very glad to be here, sharing this NMT conference with all of you. I'm going to try to be brief, because what you want is not that you speak very technical, but have time for share and to have a dialogue about what means this sentence about constitutional function of money. I think it's more interesting we can discuss about it, the consequences of the money as a creature of the state. Well, I introduce myself. I'm Miguel Arona. I lecture in constitutional law at the University of Granada in Spain. This is my third day with the same clauses because my flight company lost my baggage in New York Airport, and then I'm going to explain why I told you that. Because I think I have to do something about what is happening now in our surveillance capitalism. First of all, I'm going to do, I did my presentation on my sorry, I have to move that. I forgot. Yeah, that was my presentation. You know, my name, my university, some personal details. Oh, something. Ah, yeah. This is basically the presentation we're going to do. We are going to start speaking about money as a creature of the state. Secondly, I want to explain how money is non neutral. In a previous non-neutral evening about the material that we use as money. We're going to develop these ideas about money as a profession of the state. And finally, we're going to finish with the name of the speech. It's the constitutional function of money. Yes. The principal idea that the NMT proposed has is money as a creature of the state. As you know, and my colleague explains, we have two different schools about how money comes to societies. You know, basically, the idea of the mechanism, and then the idea of the capitalism, or the, more recently, the NIT. In any case, it's important to understand that money have a sense because state is there. Money is not just a simple relationship between people, it's a relationship between people with the state. This is a substantive idea, very, very important, especially if you are a constitutional professor, and I am, of course. But why is that is so important? Because money is a governance strategy. And that is a central idea if you want to understand how constitutions have to reflect the balancing of power that is in money. Money is not only an instrument, it's a balancing of power between the different social classes, the different sectors that compose a society. Oh. programming strategy. Why is that so important? It's very important because the way that you use money, that you produce money, that you distribute money, changes the balance of power in a society. Even what you choose a material. This idea that the value of a currency is tied to the material, as I have an NIT perspective, is not true. But doesn't mean that material knowledge is not important in a state strategy of power. Of course it is. When kings use gold or silver to do coins, they are using a material that have a characteristic, is the scarcity. And this is not a natural logic. This is something that gives power to a part of the society. You know that kings are basically the owner of the mines. So if you do coins with this kind of materials, who can do that? But that is not only a question of the past. This is happening now. After all, we transform this kind of money, this material money, in paper cards, or even in computer models that we have now. That gives power to other people in a society. As you know, print wasn't something that the people had at home during the 18th century or whatever. Print was such a serious, you know. Now, who can produce notes in a computer? Yes, bankers. It's not a strategy, and material is part of the strategy. That doesn't do about the value of the material, but material is part of the strategy. Because law is true a material. You know Malohan? Do you remember Malohan, the famous sociologist? He said, medium is the message. Money is too a medium. I'm going to remember an historical moment very recent. It was the devaluation of the pound of Harold Wilson, the Prime Minister, the last real Labour Prime Minister in the United Kingdom. You know he devaluated the pound, the sterling pound? Because you have to face, for the first time in history, probably, new forces that were creating globalization. I would like to see a small speech in just 1 second, because I think it's important what Mr. Harold Wilson, the Prime Minister, said. Please? Yes, one second. Doesn't mean that something changed in your bank and your pocket. What that means, how do we show what part of the generation where the sovereignty of the state didn't have attacks for the globalization forces? So what he tried to explain to the British people is that the sterling pound was a unit account, it was all these things that going out and money represent for an economy, inside the state, inside the borders of the United States. In face of globalization forces that represent the financialization of the globalization. Do you know what we have in that times? It's the beginning of the eurodollars. Capital without state. What banks could create money in another currency of the nations. Secondly, that happens. The beginning of that happens as a strategy of the City of London. Particularly. And third, the right things. Forces that give power to the money outside the borders. But I also try to explain the British people that the money in their pockets have the same value. It's a large and very interesting speech about 20 minutes that he explained at the issue at that point. He explained how the value of money, the valuation of money, will be better by the creating jobs and everything, even native people. That represents two wars: the sovereignty of the state against the forces of globalization. And that is because the IIT purpose, in my opinion, is so important. But we need to still working in IIT because we don't have a real explanation about what means that happens, for example. We have to change the purpose, we have to change the paradigm. I'm going to explain to you, I'm going to try, of course, honestly, a second part of globalization. This is just one part of the globalization. If you don't have globalization, but look at this one. What happened with the cryptocurrencies? Are the cryptocurrencies part of the globalization? Yes, they are. We have different globalizations. This umbrella about with this new globalization is something that describes different things. One thing could be the financialization of economy around the world, around the globe. But another very different is the forces in the internet. You know those guys? Oh, sorry. I forgot what you say. Nah. Those guys, Alexander Barr, and I don't know how to pronounce the same name from my culture, in 1990 wrote a book called Metocracy. And they describe how in the capitalism forces what happened something very, very interesting. The creation of a new segment. People who control basically internet and what happened around the internet. I'm not sure about, I believe that the cryptocurrency is not real money. But they have a problem with it. In my opinion, it's an experiment that will be happening. And this is quite important because I think we live in a Polaris moment, you know. You remember Polaris, the famous economist who recovered how market was created during the 19th century in the UK, but basically the Industrial Revolution. I think we are in another important moment that is changing everything. This surveillance capitalism is changing a lot of things. And I think cryptocurrencies are an experiment. I'm going to be very, very optimistic because if my baggage was lost in the airport of New York, I'm not sure people will be or have to be very confident in a company as Facebook. You know, it's because I guess that my experience will be with this unethical moment. After this explanation about how money represents, even in the material that is to it, represent different forces fighting for power, finally we have to come back to the origins, the Constitution. Because Constitution is our value, it's an historical moment, very important for the humanity history. Basically, Constitution means power and people. The first sentence of the American Constitution is we the people. Let me say something that Keynes told us. He said, money is a measure of value, but to regard it as having value, the substance of which it's made, and lies confusing a theatrical with the performance. Look at it. I'm not sure that that's true, but I absolutely agree that the most important is what kind of performance will be produced by money. And I also expressing a constitutional performance. Remember the three words of the French Revolution? Égalité, liberté, fraternité. You know, we, the people, have to give the answer about the constitutional function of money. What that means? Money for human rights. Money for lodging for people, money for jobs, job guarantee, etc. And that has to be the constitutional function of money. No speculation, no rich values, welfare for nobody. Thank you very much. I'm open to discuss this question. Thank you. Any question, please? Yes.
One thing is, why aren't all, for example, why aren't all currencies of all sovereign nations valued the same in this world? Because if all sovereign nations' currencies had the same value, then the IMF didn't need to exist. So what causes that discrepancy?
I'm not sure I understand what you say. If you say basically, if why inside a ballpark?
Maybe if you could, for example, in the Eurozone,
yeah.
When they were negotiating the Greek debt crisis, there was a political decision made and not a pure mathematical decision. That's an example of how you use money as power. So can you expound on that?
Yes, of course. Mathematics don't have nothing to do with politics. Money is not a question, it's not a technical question. It's a political question. The question of the Eurozone is quite simple. Doesn't exist a state called European Union. So what do they do? What they did? They made a money without a state. So the values that support the euro currency is just a stability, a fiction, because that doesn't exist. I don't have in my pocket the same euro that a German has. Because most of the money is produced by bankers. And a bank in the Eurozone is different. A bank in Spain don't have the same kind of love result. It's the Bank of Spain, the love result of a money created in Spain. That's in Germany. That produced a movement of capitals where capital arrived to Germany and surpluses countries. Basically because the background of the banks or the central bank. The European Central Bank is not a central bank. It's just a monetary policy. The dystopia of the euro, you know? Why? Because the European Central Bank is not the last resort of money. So you can see perfectly in this frame of the European Union how the decision to make a kind of money give powers to some segments of the European society. It's the same in each society. Problems are different. But the question that we have to put on the table are the same. Who has the power? How limits have the power? How control the power? These three questions are constitutional questions. You know what I mean? Constitutional law is a law about power. Who has the power? Who has the power in a society? The rest is a technical question with internet for experts, but not so important. One question, please. I would like to discuss with you.
So thank you very much for your presentation. I guess I'm kind of curious to know, where do you think, here in the last slide, you're talking about money is a measure of value, but with regard to having value, the substance which is made, this quote by Keynes. So where do you think value is derived? Because you're not okay with this quote from Keynes. So, Gisela presented an alternative perspective saying that value is established by the system of production, or I would expect something like that. But what about you? What's your feeling on it? Where does value derive? Where is the value that's created by the monetary system expressed or described as money?
Okay. Let me send you something.
Where does it come?
Okay. Economists have a problem. Basically, they try to mathematize their knowledge because they want, long time ago, become something similar to a natural science. So the values have to be a number. A value is something more important than a number. a number, you know? When we speak about the value of a currency, we speak about what policy you can make it by this currency. The value is not a number of the sterling pound of the dollar. It's how many jobs you created. How many public health system could take care of a child with cancer, for example. Do you know what I'm trying to say? In that perspective, Keynes didn't know, or probably because he doesn't know, obviously, what Mahala said. What he said, the medium is the message. Of course, the value mathematically, in a point of view of mathematics, is not a ticket, it's the performance. But tickets is important because define who can produce money. Why cryptocurrency didn't show us that people use this kind of meaning of paper? You can do that in your home. You can invent a software to make money. It's not easy. In the times of the notes, to have a printing home, it wasn't easy. Now you won't have a print in your home. But have a look during the 18th century. When kings use gold, it's because they have the property of the knight, of knights. So we have to share. One means value, of course, is the state who use its power to give value. That the strategy of power that give another kind of value to currencies. Do you hear me? I hope you understand me.
I'm not satisfied with your answer.
Say it, please.
I'm not really satisfied with your answer, but I kind of get a feeling for where you want to go, but I'm not that satisfied with your answer, but it might be because I'm an economist.
Could you wish to get it?
I'm not really satisfied with your answer, and the reason is that you didn't give me much to go on, except I do like the direction of saying what we can buy, what we can do with the money gives it the value, and
yeah,
there's a power relationship there. So it might be just that I'm an economist and I'm talking to a lawyer and we're looking at it from different angles, and that's cool too. So,
I respect your opinion, but look at the speech of Harvard. Which kind of value is speaking? The value inside the United Kingdom or outside the United Kingdom? If you are somebody who speculates on the international market, it's very important the regulation of the sterling pound during that time. But if you are working in Sheffield, it's important to you? Probably the most important is have the revaluation that keep your job. Different kind of values, different powers, situations in a society. Money is not neutral. Society is not neutral. You don't have the same rights of have a rich man in this country. That's, it's only a name, but it's not true. You have the same kind of power about information that somebody who have a journal or whatever, or a television channel. The fathers of the American Constitution know that very well. But people have forgot what means Constitution. That's my opinion. And we need a combat constitution. We need combat, we need fight for our constitution. Because forces without the legitimacy of the state, of the people, we the people of the United States, Article 1st of the American Constitution, are fighting to control our life.
In the interest of time, just one more question.
First of all, my name is Rock Chameleon. Thank you for your presentation.
Thank you.
Are you, so what you're saying about it, would I be correct in saying, you know, for instance, the fiat dollar has no intrinsic value. It has personal value. So regardless what the exchange rate does, regardless what the markets are doing, regardless what anything's doing, the dollar can't be devalued for us in America. The dollars in our pocket will always demand goods and services. As long as goods and services are available, the dollars will have personal value to us. Is that basically what you're saying?
Yeah. For example, I'm going to give you an example. Is the same the value of a dollar inside the United States of outside? You go to have a huge investment. And you go to an American bank, they will say, no, I'm gonna do, it's impossible to give you your loans here, but if you go to a tax haven, you can get it. Because the value of a dollar inside the United States is not the same outside the United States. And tax havens became one of the most important capital sources in the world. Why? Because Federal Reserve is not part of the large resort. Don't have this kind of mechanism. So value is a controversial question. And in my opinion, the most important value is value to who? Value for working class, value for rich people, value something abstract doesn't exist. It's value for a person, a real person. That's what means constitution. But we forgot, long time ago, what means constitution. Constitution is not only how to open the American Senate or whatever. It's who has the power in a society. More questions?
I think we got to move on for time, but thank you.
Thank you very much.
Hi everybody, my name is Sam Levy, I'm a consultant on this panel, and it's my turn to speak. So just a little bit about me, I am a graduate student at the University of Missouri, Kansas City. I've been there about 2 years. Before that, well I guess I'm one of a growing body of people who discovered NMT first and said, okay, I've got to go to Kansas City. So before that I was into NMT, I'm founder of a group called Deficit Owls, which Bill Peoples here helps me out quite a bit with kind of MMT advocacy kind of stuff. And before that, I had a totally different life in a completely different field as an audio engineer for musicals. It's a good time. So what I want to talk about is kind of what I've been working on for the last year and a half in my non-existent spare time. And because I'm an academic, or trained to be an academic, that means I get to make up words. So I'm calling it mobilization theory. So I'm very interested in this historical analogy between World War II and a Green New Deal. So my impulse was, let's study World War II in a little more depth to find out about, you know, what they were thinking, the challenges they faced, and how we can use those lessons for a Green New Deal. So I've been working on a paper recently that kind of makes the case for this mobilization theory as a more specific study of these kinds of national emergencies that require major mobilization of our nation's resources. So that paper covers things like the planning process for these kinds of things in broad strokes, the role of different kinds of controls and, you know, what those kinds of policy levers and what they do for us. Understanding their relationship to these kind of emergency situations. And then I had a paper come out just a few weeks ago as a working paper with the Global Institute for Sustainable Prosperity, which is called Modern Money and the War Treasury, and that was sort of a historical dive into the U.S. Treasury during World War II. How did they, you know, piecing together how they were conceiving the way the economy works. And that for me, that was kind of like, I think I just stumbled onto some documents, and I started finding quotations immediately that you would have thought that Stephanie Kelton wrote, or that Randy Ray wrote, things that just very closely paralleled what the MMTers are saying today. So the point of that paper was to dig into those sources, dissect what they were saying in more detail, compare with MMT, and you find that they understood very clearly things that, like, banks create money, that taxes function to prevent inflation, that the government deficit, you know, is equal to a private surplus. They understood those things quite clearly. And they also understood that it was all about real resources and not about financial resources. So that paper has got historical sources on that. And one thing I started to find that I had a very difficult time reconciling was they understood that view, that part of it quite clearly, a very functional finance type view. But then on the other hand, when they would talk about debt, national debt, the remarks were very conventional sounding. And I thought that was quite confusing. If you have this more functional finance view, how can you then be saying mainstream things about debt, like the debt burden, and you know it's going to burden our grandchildren, and things like that? And so I was trying to dig into that more, which is sort of motivating this paper that I'm nominally writing. It's a hot mess right now, but hopefully you know soon it will exist, which I'm kind of calling National Emergency and National Debt, to understand the situation of debt in these major mobilization emergencies and how it behaves differently than debt in normal peacetime. And I haven't seen anyone cover this in the MMT world before, so I think it's filling a hole. So really quickly, the conventional view on national debt that comes from mainstream economists and the punditry and political class, there's worries that if the deficit is large or the debt is large, then interest rates will rise and that will crowd out private investment. There might be the bond vigilantes who will refuse to buy the government's debt and bring the fiscal, you know, authority to discipline or whatever. We have a burden because if we have debt today, in the future we'll need taxes to pay, we'll need to raise taxes to pay down that debt. Although even that, they'll admit, only applies if the interest rate is greater than the growth rate, which means the debt to GDP ratio explodes. And then there's also frictional costs from the taxes needed to service the debt. So we have to levy taxes to pay the interest on the debt, and they understand that, you know, that those taxes take money and the debt and the interest payments return the money, so it's not like a net loss of payment there, but there's frictional costs, they call it, from like incentive distortions. I'm not gonna go into that in detail. So this kind of view, and one more thing, inflation expectations play a role if investors you know, expect inflation and they'll demand a higher interest rate, they'll force interest rates up. So this kind of view tacitly assumes full employment. You know, some versions, I mean, obviously mainstream economists don't make sense, maybe the extreme sort of like real business cycle people don't you know, pretend that we're at full employment all the time, but this view kind of assumes, oh, full employment in the long run or something like that. The MMT view is generally quite different, does not assume we're at full employment. In fact, we're not at full employment most of the time. There is no crowding out. MMT replaces that with the more endogenous money view of financial markets. Bond vigilantes don't exist. Our system creates huge structural demand for treasury securities, and even if it didn't, we have basically regulations that primary dealers must buy treasury bonds. So those kind of self-imposed constraints aren't binding. The normal historical case is for the interest rate to be less than the growth rate. So even if we were running the deficits, the debt to GDP ratio will stabilize. It's a little math game you can play. But if that's the case, then you don't need to raise taxes in the future to pay down the debt because relative to the economy, it's shrinking anyway. Interest costs in the functional finance view, you know, interest payments could be stimulative. That's income for people. They could spend that income. That could be inflationary pressure if we're in a full employment economy. But outside of that, that's not so much of an issue. And then inflation expectations in the MMT view generally is along the lines of the expectations hypothesis for the yield curve. So what that means is that long-term interest rates on government debt are primarily determined by what the Fed does. So monetary policy is kind of the determining factor in interest rates. And if the market thinks that inflation will cause the Fed to tighten, then that might raise interest rates, but otherwise it won't. So that's kind of the standard MMT view. And I think that in these mobilization situations of like, you know, like a Green New Deal might be, and like World War II certainly was, I think this is kind of an under-theorized case, understandably, because we don't do it that often. So the key feature here is that in one of these situations, in World War II, we actually do have full employment basically 100% of the time. Not only that, there is probably an inflationary gap. So what I mean by that is, left unchecked, the total demand for goods and services would be in excess of the productive capacity of the economy, driving up prices as people bid for scarce goods and services. So in these situations, that kind of becomes a major function of financial policy for the government. How do we prevent inflation in these situations, right? And so that was another thing that I found when I was digging through historical sources on the US Treasury during the war. They will write all the time, money is quite easy for us to get, that's not a worry, our primary concern is controlling inflation. So inflationary gap, So, you know, the question is, if you're in the situation of full employment and you need more resources to prosecute the war, and you don't think you can raise taxes for one reason or another, you need to increase the deficit. So how do you do that? How do you increase the deficit when you're already at full employment without spiraling inflation, right? I mean, one way to do it is kind of those non-fiscal pay-fors that Nathan talked about yesterday, to release resources from other sectors, you know, regulate finance, make it smaller, regulate, you know, the environment, environmental regulations to reduce, release resources from industries that aren't important in the kind of emergency climate so that the government can have them. So there's sort of a specific way to do that of kind of specific controls. This industry, you have to be smaller. That industry, you can't have this. Then there's also a general way to do it, which is a savings policy. So we talked a little bit about that yesterday, and sort of there's two ways that savings policies goes. They are, you know, there's a voluntary form where the government kind of, you know, implores people to reduce their spending on goods and services to free up resources for the government to buy them. And then there's the compulsory way where the government sort of mandates one way or another, you can't buy this now, you save your money and you'll be able to buy things later. And so there's a few different forms that could take. There's like refundable taxes, there's, you know, expanding Social Security and raising the tax. And that's another interesting one that I think they actually did that during World War II for its anti-inflationary impact. They raised the tax, at the same time they raised Social Security benefits in the future. So at the immediate moment, it's kind of net inflationary. But, so increasing the deficit while you're already at full employment, running a saving policy to reduce private demand for goods and services. So, you know, what I'm going to talk about really, I think, is the consequences of the saving policy, not the debt per se, but the savings are the debt, right? People end up with government liabilities in the form of currency or treasury securities or whatever. So those savings are the government debt, right? So there's kind of a two-way street there. So what are the properties of this kind of government debt? And you issue government debt by forcing people to save money that they would not have otherwise been doing. That's the kind of key feature here. So first of all, the bond vigilantes. So I would not say that we would be in danger of people refusing to buy treasury securities with cash per se. And in fact, the point of the saving policy is just to reduce demand for goods and services. It doesn't actually matter what form people save in. They put cash under the mattress, they buy war bonds, they pay down debt, they buy life insurance, all of that's all good, and they understood that very clearly during World War II. But if you can't actually convince people to save, then your saving policy is not going to work. Or if your mechanism for forcing them to save isn't, you know, effective, then your saving policy is not going to work. And so the result is that government spending is going to be inflationary because you're increasing the deficit at full employment. So another aspect here is interest rates. Like I said, the MMT view is that monetary policy is the driver of interest rates, and I would certainly not deny that here. However, you know, if you need people to save and to increase their saving, one way to do it might be to offer them a reward in the form of more interest, right? That's a choice, it's a tool, but, you know, raising interest rates may or may not actually work. We know that people's spending behavior, both consumers and businesses, is not actually very sensitive to interest rates, but maybe it would work a little bit. So if you perhaps do that, that might, you know, if you raise interest rates, maybe people save more, so maybe that reduces the inflationary aspect of government spending in that situation. However, I mean, yeah, like I just said, both consumer and investment spending not particularly well related to interest rates, and especially in sort of these emergency climates, the government tends to be tightly controlling those kinds of things anyway. Like I said, direct regulations on this industry can have that, you guys can't do this. So a lot of, you know, in that circumstance, business investment is more directly regulated than with interest rates anyway. But it is an option. The role of inflation expectations in this kind of debt. If you think that your currency is about to be inflated away, you probably don't want to save in that unit of account. So to the extent that inflation expectations lead people to not want to save, that could cause government spending to be more inflationary because your saving policy isn't working, right? So in that situation, well, maybe you might want to raise interest rates to compensate for the expected loss people might, you know, they're expecting to induce them to save. Another thing you could do is offer inflation index securities. They used to call them purchasing power bonds. Today in the US, they're called TIPS, Treasury Inflation Protected Securities. So those are bonds that instead of the kind of nominalism debt that Giselle was talking about, those are indexed to some measure of the price level. So if there's inflation, then the value of the bond increases automatically legally, so consumers get compensated for that inflation, right? Of course, the problem with those kinds of bonds is that they're inflationary. If you give people savings that are indexed to inflation that expand, then when inflation happens, now people have more money to spend, right? So that's kind of a catch-22 or can be. Another thing that can matter, what I'm kind of referring casually to as mobilization expectations. So that's like, how soon is this war or emergency going to end? Because if this war is going to last 15 years, then asking me to save 40% of my income is going to be a pretty tough sell to do that every year. If war is going to end next year, then okay, that's an easier ask, right? Another aspect is it going to end successfully? If I think that this is a big war and we're going to lose the war and the government is going to be disbanded and the currency is going to be, you know, just abandoned, then I probably don't want to save in that unit, right? So if people have sort of poor expectations of how the emergency is going to wind up, then the saving policy won't be very effective and the government spending will be more inflationary. And debt to GDP. I think MMT makes a quite convincing case that for peacetime debt, the debt to GDP should not be a policy variable. To the extent that it matters at all, it will take care of itself. But in these cases, you know, the public probably can only be induced to save so much. There's only so much money that you want to accumulate relative to your lifestyle, and past that, to implore people to save anymore is going to be a tough sell. Even to force them to save anymore is going to be a tough sell. Compulsory saving can be avoided in various ways. So if the debt to GDP ratio gets too high, you know, that means people have accumulated all these savings that they might eventually, you know, or now want to spend, and then your saving policy becomes ineffective, government spending becomes inflationary. And then there's a role here for after the emergency. So those savings represent pent-up demand, basically. That's, you know, when people are saving, really what that means is they're doing labor today for the promise of goods and services in the future. And during the war, people are saving a lot. They're accumulating money that they hope they'll spend after the war or after the Green New Deal or whatever. So, you know, it's postponed demand in some sense. And that means that after the war, after the emergency, inflation is still likely to be a problem for quite a while. And, you know, we'll have, I mean, this definitely happened after World War II. They let down the controls and policies sort of too soon. And so in 1946, we had a pretty good inflation going. And then, you know, these savings that were built up during the war kept aggregate demand high for the ensuing years, the kind of full employment, golden age of capitalism era. So anti-inflationary policies are going to probably have to continue after the emergency is over. And the more of this kind of debt there is, which I'm referring to casually as mobilization debt, that's this debt that is issued during periods of full employment with saving policies. The more of this mobilization debt there is, then probably the longer and stricter those anti-inflationary policies are going to have to be after the emergency is over, right? So from an MMT perspective, in peacetime, when people say, we run a deficit today, that means we'll have to raise taxes in tomorrow, well, that's really not very true. But in these circumstances, there's a little more basis for that, you know, to the extent that taxation is not the only way to prevent inflation, but it's an essential tool, I would say, that in a strong inflationary environment, you can't go without. So to the extent that you build up a lot of savings by issuing this mobilization debt, then after the emergency is over, we need inflation control for a long time. That includes taxes. So when somebody says, in this circumstance,
a deficit today means higher taxes in the future. That's got more truth to it. So for a Green New Deal, I think the application here is pretty obvious. We will probably be at full employment for significant chunks of the Green New Deal and still need more resources. A saving policy is a very powerful tool that I expect we will use fully. Contrary to what Professor Narcissian was saying yesterday, you know, the Keynes argument for a compulsory saving policy is that voluntary savings just won't work. It just won't be big enough. You can't get people to do it. I think the quote from How to Pay for the War is like, anybody who believes that voluntary savings will work is a victim of their own propaganda. Okay. Talk yourself into believing that people are more patriotic than they actually are. But in a wartime, you know, if the government is expanding from 5% to 50% of GDP and people need to reduce their spending of goods and services by 45% of their income, okay, that's a big ask. On the other hand, the slide that Professor Narcissian had up here yesterday said that the Green New Deal kind of net resource needs would probably be 1% of GDP. And I think that asking people to voluntarily save 1% of GDP is probably doable. Anyway, so we'll probably have a saving policy if we do a Green New Deal. And so we will have this kind of mobilization debt issued at full employment with a saving policy. And so we'll have to manage it after the war. And I wanted to say one more thing. So we hear all the time from the pundits that national debt is burdening our future. And NMT argues that that is not true, that goods and services are not transported through time from the past, so you're not borrowing from future generations, unless they invent a time machine or something. And I agree with that. But what mobilization debt does is shift the allocation of the burden. So the burden of the war, of the Green New Deal, is the people, who have to forego goods and services today. If the government needs a car, then you can't have a car, right? So somebody has to forego that car so that the government can have it. How do we figure out who that person is? One way to do it is taxes, raise taxes, so somebody decides not to buy a car because their taxes are raised. When we have a saving policy, what we're saying is, okay, forego the car today, but in the future, we'll give you something to kind of make up for us, right? The burden is absolutely not being shifted to the future. That burden is felt right now by the person who doesn't get a car, but coupled with that promise of, we'll make it up to you later, right? If that time comes when the person demands or, you know, demands to be made up, it is time, I want something now to make up for this loss you made me bear in the past, and we're in a full employment economy already, then the only way for that person to consume more is for somebody else to consume less, right? And I mean, if we're still running a saving policy at that time, then what's happening is this burden is being reallocated, right? This person, we say, okay, you bore that loss 10 years ago, that car, we'll make it up to you now, here's a car now. The only way we can give you that car now, because we're in a full employment tight economy, is this other person here can't have a car and we'll make it up to them at some point in the future, or we'll raise their taxes now or do some kind of controls now so that we're actually not gonna make it up to them, right? So what I'm trying to say is, it is true that costs like that can't be shifted to the future, but they can be reallocated in the future. We can say, yes, we charge you, but we'll make it up. Kind of moral of the story, I think we need to be thinking about these circumstances. Digging into the literature from World War II is extremely helpful for these problems because it's what they actually faced. And actually the most productive literature from that era is actually from about 1950-1951. You know, during the war, people were busy fighting the war and managing the economy, but in the early 50s, when the Korean War was looming, people started writing once again, okay, war is coming, we're going to have to deal with it. Here's what we learned from World War II, here's how we managed these things, and they face these issues, and we should learn from it. So, thank you.
Very important what you're doing and very interesting too. One thing I've observed is I think most people, including myself, really until I read the Narcissian Gray piece, hadn't really thought of the Green New Deal or the whole climate crisis as something like World War II where we would go for a hump of activity and then be somewhat back to normal. I thought of it, and I think most people think of it as a continuing problem, and obviously it is. But this, I realized now that there's just this tremendous need for changeover, you know, transformation that will then subside back to a somewhat more normal. So I think, you know, that's a very important thing that for you to bring out, as obviously you will. That's what makes it similar to World War II. I have a kind of technical observation, kind of sort of a nerdy observation. I hope I can get this right. One of the things that we say in MMT, and Scott, for instance, would be very strong on this, is that it's not necessary to borrow money, run up national debt, or when you run a deficit. We could just allow bank reserves to rise instead, and it really wouldn't make that much difference. What difference does it make whether banks and people hold cash versus holding treasury bonds? They're both highly liquid. And yet here we are thinking about World War II and then the Green New Deal, where we would be saying, in a way, the opposite. We would be saying, yes, it is useful to get people to save instead of have cash. And I think what we're talking about, obviously, is we're trying to get consumers, ordinary people, to save when they normally would spend. So I'm just, there must be kind of a trade-off here as you go through the income levels, perhaps. But there is an inconsistency there, potentially, that I just thought I'd make that observation, because we're so used to saying, oh, it doesn't matter whether people have cash or treasury bonds, it's all the same.
So I think it can matter, but most of the time it doesn't. The question is, how liquid are treasury bonds? Like, are they convertible into money? And so one argument would be, okay, it's a war, we want people to not spend, so maybe we give them illiquid savings instruments. So that's a form, this is a form of compulsory saving. Give you something that actually can't be converted to cash, like maybe until the war is over or something. During World War II, we actually weren't doing that. We were issuing savings bonds that were redeemable on demand. So you didn't even have to go sell it, you just go to the office and they'll give you money instantly. So in that circumstance, yeah, treasury securities really are basically the same thing as cash. They're convertible into cash instantly, more or less. But the value of war bonds in the war is the patriotic element, you know, the psychology of it. You have a thing, it's not just your paper money that you deal with every day, but it's a United States war bond. It's a savings instrument. You have, by buying it, you have pledged, I am contributing to the war, I'm helping out, you know, I'm patriotic. So there's like a kind of more psychological inducement, maybe not to turn that back into cash and spend it. But like I said, the form of the savings doesn't matter that much. You keep it under the mattress, you buy war bonds, it's all the same.
Very good paper. Just the postponed consumption, the aggregate level is going to be postponed for them. It's going to be permanent. Those bonds are going to remain outstanding. They might shift hands. The individual might view it as postponing consumption. But in the future, someone else is going to postpone consumption and take that bond off your hands. They're not going to be redeeming. And if the World War II, of course, greatly increased capacity, the Green New Deal should increase capacity for a different kind of consumption, but our ability to satisfy needs will be increased. And so it's not actually going to be a burden ever.
I think it's just a question of how much inflationary pressure will there be once it's over. And I, like you, I'm quite confident that it probably will not be very much. In World War II, especially in the immediate post-war period, as the economy was transitioning, and there wasn't very much consumer, you know, output to buy, that was a different story. And it could be a different story if it's a long drawn out war, a lot of savings, and, you know, I mean, one of the major advantages that a Green New Deal has, like you said, we're producing things that will make the private economy more productive later. In a war, yes, we innovate, and there, you know, was a huge increase in output, but at the end of the day, you're producing guns and tanks that will either be destroyed or useless once the war is over. So a Green New Deal has a major advantage in that sense.
Yes. And one important thing to consider during the Second World War was that the investment increased a lot in the war industry. And this inflation increased productivity, technology. And after the Second World War, it came the commercial or the war industry, the commercial industry. And this inflation increased productivity and increased inflation and increased economic growth.
Was there a question or was that?
Yes, I think that you need to consider this situation, no? The two different situations that generated the Second World War and then improved the commercial industry and the productivity in the country.
Right, I mean, yeah, that's kind of what I was just saying. So, you know, there were technological improvements during the war, of course, but a lot of the output was just wasted, basically. And a Green New Deal will have the technological improvements and will have the actual output. You know, so that should keep inflationary pressure, hopefully, quite low after it's over. Oh. Yeah, we should stop. So, thank you very much, everybody.
Hello everyone. Our next presenter is Professor Anthony Huerta, and he will be talking about austerity in Mexico. Please welcome him to the stage.
Hi. Thanks for being here. Last year, in the electoral and political party won the election in Mexico, but nonetheless, and they maintain the same economic policy, neoliberal economic policy. In this case, they are working with a fiscal surplus for 1% of the GDP, and for 2020, they are going to work with a fiscal surplus of 0.7%. And in this year, the Mexican economy doesn't grow. The economic growth is slow. And the interest rate is 8%, and yesterday decreased 7.75%. Okay. The problem is that, all the economic policy. The objective is to decrease inflation, is to stabilize the exchange rate, and the objective of growth and employment doesn't exist anymore. And why the objective is the stabilization of the exchange rate and more inflation? It's act in favor of capital inflow. The Mexican economy depends on capital inflow. And the financial capital needs the stabilization of the currency where they work. And with the autonomy of central bank in 1994, we lost the government lost the control of the money, and then he has been working with fiscal discipline, and we have been working with high interest rate. Fiscal discipline and all these macroeconomical policies acting against for the productive sector. Nonetheless, that they say that they work with flexible exchange rate, they do everything in order to maintain the stability of the exchange rate. And then we have lost competitiveness, and we have a external deficit, And this situation, in order to maintain the stability of the exchange rate, we promote, the government promotes capital inflow. And I'm, that's the situation. Why? Because we have a high interest rate and fiscal discipline. And that means we are in a vital circle. Yes, how the government has got fiscal surplus. They have sold public enterprises, they have decreased investment in the strategic sector, and the situation decreased the participation of the state in the economy and increased the participation of the private, national, and external sector in the economy in order to promote capital inflow. And then the fiscal policy is coordinated to the interest of financial capital, and we don't have a fiscal policy in order to generate, to respond to the public objectives. What is behind of the prevailing stability policies? It's in order to decrease that why the government lost the control of the money, in order to decrease the participation of the state in the economy. Why we lost the control of the money in order to decrease the participation in the economy and in order to increase the privatization of the economy. Yes, the current government trying to avoid a low rating from rating agencies. We can see how rating agencies, they have more power now than the International Monetary Fund. Every week, the government talk with the rating agencies in order to, to generate the economic policy. In September 8th, the Treasury Secretary presented the budget for 2020, and he said in his speech, we hope that we can be seen good for the rating agencies. So, and we, this question reflects that we have lost the sovereignty in order to manage the economic policy. The government generated a policy against of corruption. But they think that with this, they can get the balance of the budget. Yes, in this year, they are spending the same as last year. So, in order not to increase fiscal deficit, and we are going to a recession. Yes, the government has the government has said that they don't invest in order that the private sector could be the engine of the economic growth. But how the private government can invest if we have a external deficit, no? And we have fiscal surplus, and then we have a deficit in the private sector. Then, and they are decreasing in consumption and investing in order to pay the debt. That's the reason that we don't know. Yes, we don't, nonetheless, that they say that we have fiscal policy in order to work with a contracyclical situation, we don't have. No? It's a procyclical economic policy. Austerity with high interest rate, they maintain a safe exchange rate that decreases our competitiveness and increases the external sector. We don't have conditions in order to grow to the domestic market. We don't have conditions in order to grow to the external sector, unless we be a protectionist economic policy of the United States. 80% of our exports go to the United States. And then how the external deficit acts against of the private finance and the public finance. Because especially the increased economic growth, and finally the government gets more, gets less tax income. In this year, in the first 7 months, the income tax has decreased 10%, and the aggregate value tax has decreased 7.4%. Fiscal austerity intensified the structural problems of the economy and accentuated its existing problems. We don't have a budget condition in order to grow. And the private sector can't act as an engine of economic growth. And the insolvency problems have been increasing. Yes, because the interest rate is very high. The interbank interest rate is 7.75%, but the commercial interest rate is 20-30%, and the economic growth is zero. Then insolvency and problems are increasing, and we are going to back in crisis. Nonetheless, that they are decreasing the public spending, we can decrease the fiscal deficit, and they can decrease the debt. Because they are receiving less tax income. The present situation of stagnation and the decline of the stock market reduce income and asset values, that its situation increase the insolvency problems. Now we are living in a context that there are global austerity in all the world, and then we don't have permission in order to go to the domestic market and the external market. If nonetheless that they always say that fiscal discipline is in order to generate stability, we don't have any stability. No? Yes, the banking system, they have a high in profits, but the stability, you know, is related with the stability of the exchange rate. The stability is related with the property sector, with the macroeconomic variables, you know, the standard sector, finance of the private sector and public sector. And we don't have any stability in these sectors. Yes. It's inappropriate with the fiscal discipline. You can't maintain fiscal discipline in a stagnation situation because it's a growing policy, acts procyclical, and we are going to a recession. Yes, we can continue with this growing policy, and we can continue with free trade. Because in order to maintain the trade deficit, we need to maintain high interest rate, fiscal discipline, and this growing policy acts against the endogenous situation and maintains the pressure of the external sector. And we don't have more assets to sell in order to promote capital inflow to finance the trade deficit. Cannot continue with policies that reduce the size of the government, leading us to more markets stagnation and recurring in crisis. Yes, and then this situation reflects the failure of the neoliberal economic policy in Mexico and all the world. We achieve a sovereign. Yes, how can we achieve a sovereign mandate of economic policy to meet national needs? Yes, we need to control money in order to have a monetary exchange rate and fiscal policy in favor of the economic growth. We have lost sovereignty because we maintain movements of capitals. And movement of capitals needs exchange rate stability. And in this situation, we can not decrease interest rate. We cannot work with fiscal deficit in favor of the economic growth. Fiscal policy plays an important role in stabilizing the economy, but this is not achieved with fiscal balance, but by acting contra-cyclical. Fiscal policy must act according to the finance desired balance of the private sector and external sector. Yes, they say we maintain a responsible economic policy with fiscal surplus. Come on, no? A responsible fiscal policy is to consider what is the situation of the private sector and what is the situation of the external sector. The external sector is in deficit that acts against the private sector and that acts against the economic growth. You need a fiscal deficit in order to increase productivity, in order to increase the production, in order to produce locally the products that you import in order to decrease external deficit. And this equation doesn't exist in my country. It's necessary to increase employment and wages to create economic growth. In order to last, you need to have a monetary exchange rate policy and fiscal policy to get set out of this. Greater public spending doesn't increase interest rate or inflation. We have excess capacity. We have a very high unemployment. And then we have conditions in order to increase public spending. And you don't need to increase taxes, you don't need to generate, issue debt, because if you increase public spending in favor of productivity, in favor of production capacity, you are going to generate inflation and you are going to generate external deficit. Yes. And this equation doesn't increase the burden on future generations. Most companies that produce for the domestic market, they are in favor of higher public spending. But the problem is that the corporate leadership, they are in favor of fiscal discipline. Why? Because with fiscal discipline, the corporate leadership, they increase their participation in the economy. They invest where the government decreased investment. In the neoliberal governments, the Mexican government, they didn't invest in payments, they didn't invest in the electrical industry, they didn't invest in infrastructure, and the corporate leadership, they just invest in that sectors. So, and now the current government, the left current government, they try to recover the oil industry and the electrical industry for the country. And this situation has reduced the capital inflow to the energy sector. But they maintain high interest rate in order to promote capitalism. And then high interest rate decrease the economic growth. Yes, high public expenditure is required to reduce the amount of public debt. Yes, because they are decreasing the budget spending in order to decrease public deficit, in order to decrease debt, but this situation, they don't get these objectives. They say that they have a high public debt, and that the situation that they need to decrease, they need to save in order to pay. No? But the problem is that they can pay if they don't spend. High public debt is not an impediment to more public spending on the public sector and in employment. Yes, the government receive, capital if the tax income depends of spending. If the government doesn't spend, they are going to increase tax income. No? I told you that in this year, the income tax has decreased 10% because they are decreasing spending. Yes, Sweden government doesn't face financial constraints. The Mexican government doesn't have a subordinate itself to the opinions of international rating agencies. Yes, they are worried, no? About what is going to be the reaction of the rating agencies. But the interest rate in the world is very low. No? And the government doesn't need to go to the international financial market for money. They can use their own money in order to spend in favor of the productive sectors. It has to recover the jointly management of the economic policy. Fiscal policy must work with a flexible exchange rate. Yes. Because nonetheless, that we have been working with flexible exchange rates in 1995, they do everything in order to contain the stability of the exchange rate in favor of the financial capital. Government spending is not limited by its income, but by the available resources of the economy. And the problem is that we have less available resources for the economy, because public and private investment have decreased for a lot of years. Yes, in 1980, the public investment was 13.1% of the GDP, and now it's 2.5%. Total investment, private and public investment in 1980 was, no, 1994 was 22%, and now it's 22%. The decrease, the lower public investment hasn't been compensated for higher in private investment. What stabilizes an economy is improving its productive condition and its management of the external sector. Yes. You need, in order to increase public spending, you need to act in favor of the local production. I mean, you need to control capital external sector in order to avoid that imports can go. No? Yes, but Mexico is the second country in the world with more free trade agreements. And the new government doesn't question the situation. In the new trade agreement with Canada, Mexico, and United States, Canada, and Mexico, the Congress of Mexico was the first one that approved this new agreement. The Congress of the United States, until now, they haven't approved, and Canada neither. Yes, if the government wants to collect more, he needs to spend more, no? But they don't think in this way. Only through economic growth can the fiscal deficit and the amount of debt be reduced. So, next week, I'm going to give a lecture in the Congress about this. I hope to have enough time in order to make it all right. The one thing. Monetary policy must accommodate fiscal policy to boost growth and employment. A government must have control of the currency to control fiscal policy and to meet the objectives of government and productive growth. Monetary policy must incorporate economic growth and its objectives. Now I am a pastor of the one political party in the Congress, and I wrote an initiative of law in favor to change the objectives of the central bank. Because until now, the only objective is to maintain stability of the money, low inflation. And then I introduced that they have to battleize low inflation with high employment and high economic growth like in the United States. And the principal and political party, they say no. Yes, because in order to get low inflation with higher employment and economic growth, you can't increase interest rates because the Central Bank of Mexico, they have decreased inflation with high interest rates. No? They don't want to decrease interest rates in order to combine low inflation with economic growth. And then it's a political decision. A political decision is needed to change the prevailing economic policy. Yes, I have discussed with the politician that last year the left party got 53% of the national votation. And then I have asked how many votes we need in order to change the economic policy. Thank you.
Listening to your presentation and reading the key points about your country, I would say that this is the same points I would use presenting my country right now. So, the total similarities.
Where are you from?
I'm from Ukraine. So, this is like a mirror picture. But my question is, like, you explained these political decisions, but my reading of media, of the elections you had, that you elected a president, new president, like people made decisions to elect a new president, and he was kind of about improving people's lives. So he had great support. What kind of like considerations he personally was having in order to preserve the policy making, which was inherited from the previous government and previous president? Why he maintained that structure?
In the president's speech, he always says that the current government is the finish of the neoliberal policies, but nonetheless, they maintain the neoliberal policies. And his policy is against corruption, and he considered that corruption, to fight against corruption is to combine the neoliberal positions. Yes, in the current moment, any left economist is inside. Talking with a friend from Chile, I studied in Chile in 1970 to 1973. I left Chile 1 month before the COVID did. And all the principal left economists were in the government of Allende. And any left economists in Mexico are in the government. The president of Mexico, he knows me very well. Since the 1990s, and he always had considered me like a radical. And then he is put in jail a lot of former people from the government, without the government. But yes, the financial capital is totally happy. Because they maintain the same economic policy. So, last November, I presented an initiative. I'm not a deputy, but I'm advisor. An initiative in order to government control the pension funds in favor to the strategic sector, in favor of to generate employees, And the new board said no. And they presented a new initiative in favor of the private financial sector controls the pension funds in order that they can invest these funds in the international stock markets in order to look for better profits.
You hear a lot of these words being thrown around in the news, the OMB, the CBO, and like they're just acronyms for most people. But today we're having Sherry Weiss, who will be telling us what exactly they do and why we need it or don't need it from an MMT purpose. Please welcome Sherry Weiss.
Personally, so this is not a presentation that has anything really related to do with my job, except that this is sort of comes from some of my experiences at my job. But anything I say should not be considered representative of the United States government or the U.S. Department of Energy. So just that disclaimer. Okay, so clicker. The Office of Management and Budget, what it is and what you need to know. I'm going to really mostly talk about the Office of Management and Budget. We already know pretty much about the CBO, Congressional Budget Office, but a lot of people don't know a whole lot about Office of Management and Budget, so what I'm trying to do is basically be familiar with it and so you understand the difference between it and the CBO. Okay, the Office of Management and Budget is an agency that is directly under the President of the United States. So this is an office that basically answers to the President. And it is, as opposed to CBO is a congressional agency. It exists to provide advice and information to the members of Congress as their, basically evaluate on, forming bills. But what OMB does is it actually is on the other side of that in the executive office after the bill becomes a law. Then basically what OMB does is it shepherds the bills through the administrative process, through the regulatory process, so that we end up with a regulation or regulations that tell us how we're going to implement the law, okay? So It is administrative law. It's basically helping to formulate administrative law rather than statutory law. Okay. OMB does not actually do analyses. What it does is when a law is passed, it's going to be under a certain jurisdiction of a particular agency, depending on what the subject matter of the rule is. And that is going to, OMB is going to basically determine where it's going to go. Then what happens is the agency does the analysis for the rules. OMB oversees it. So that's the difference there. Okay, so OMB's functions. They actually do quite a bit, but the last one is the most important to us. But first, they prepare the president's budget. So when the president, basically prepares a budget for the next fiscal year, it's actually the Office of Management and Budget that does it. They oversee the management of the executive branch. So they're basically the management authority for all of the executive branch. And so that also gives it quite a bit of power. They issue executive orders and presidential memorandums. So if the president's put out an executive order, it comes out through OMB. And then they conduct legislative clearance and coordination, which is what I'm basically talking about, is shepherding the law through the regulatory process to actually come up with a rule of regulation. And when I say rule of regulation, it's pretty much the same thing. And so they are the lead, as a result, they are the lead on regulatory policy. So that means that they're the ones that are going to oversee everything and manage it, but they're the ones that are going to oversee everything, and they're the ones that have to have final approval of the regulation. Okay. So this is the regulatory process. So this is, you see, we remember the little videos from school, how a bill becomes a law. Well, this is how a law becomes a regulation. And what basically happens is it's initiated. Usually it's because of a law that Congress passes. But regulations don't necessarily have to come out of legislation. They may come about because an agency got sued for not enforcing something properly. Or the agency sees that there's a weakness in an existing piece of legislation, things have changed, and so they want to make a change in the regulation to update it. OMB makes a determination of whether or not this thing actually needs to go through the whole process. Once they do that, in the process of doing that, they also make a determination of how much, it's not an estimate, but they decide, is this going to be a significant rule, or is this going to just be, something that's not really significant in terms of its impact on the economy or, other considerations, which I'll talk about in a minute. So it goes to the, after the determinant of the, it goes to the agency. Prepares a proposed rule, and then the Office of Management and Budget reviews it. Once they approve the proposal, it goes to the Federal Register. It's published in the Federal Register. Public gets an opportunity to public comment on it for 60 days. And after they comment, then the agency takes those comments, and all the other comments have to be read and acknowledged. And so it has to be addressed in the final regulation. So then they prepare the final rule. OMB again reviews it, gives it one last pass to see whether or not it's sufficient, and then it's published. Okay, now, there are a list of requirements, for you know, how a rule is supposed to be developed. And one of the things, and some of them include analytical reviews. The first one is one that I'm going to talk about, and the one in red is the one that I'm mostly going to talk about. I'll talk a little bit about the second one. The first one is the regulatory planning and review. It's called regulatory planning and review analysis, and it is has been authorized by Executive Order 12866. Now, 12866, and I'm going to explain it in just a minute, but it is something that comes out of the Clinton administration, but it follows something that the Reagan administration first administered, and it really basically says we have to have benefit cost analysis for the impact of this rule. And what the thing that's important about this is that from an economics perspective is that it identifies any rule that has an impact on the economy of 100 million or more has to go through all this process. So they have to do the economic impact analysis or regulatory impact analysis, okay, which includes a benefit cost analysis. Okay, and then the second one is the Regulatory Flexibility Act, and that one, Congress required that we look at, agencies look at the impact on small businesses. So it's not just that you look at what's going to happen in the economy overall, it's that you want to look, we're supposed to evaluate, okay, is this going to harm small businesses in particular? Okay. The very first thing is the thing that people mostly kind of focus on. Is it going to be, when we talk about a significant rule, is it going to have this economic impact? But there are also a couple of other things. Basically, will it cause any inconsistencies with any other policy, existing laws, programs? And the last one basically means, really, like the most part means, is it going to be really controversial? Even if it doesn't have a big impact on the economy, the OMB might determine that it's significant because I think it's going to be very it's going to get a lot of attention, and so they want to make sure that everything is above, everything is, all the T's are crossed and all the I's are dotted. So to me, they may, even if it's less than 100 million, they may require it. Okay. And then this executive order is one that was issued by the Obama administration, and really pretty much what it does is it strengthens the original executive order. And it requires that cost and benefits be quantified as much as possible. And it also allows stakeholders to be involved in the rulemaking process. So those things are pretty interesting. Now, the regulatory impact analysis, what does it have in it? It focuses on the economic aspects of the industry. Okay, it looks at the industry, kind of describes the industry, but it also then focuses on the regulation itself, what some policy options are, and the economic impact. And it requires us to actually look at some different options and choose among those options, value-added options. It also requires an economic justification for the rule. When we look at the economic justification, OMB has created a circular, A4, I think it is, that details what exactly they're looking at in these things. And so what they want for economic justification, for the most part, is market fit. That would be externalities, or when there's an effect from an economic the market that isn't accounting for public goods, things basically that don't, they're provided by the government that you don't have like individual prices, things like that. Monopoly power and information asymmetry. Information asymmetry is, for instance, a classic example is, well, that's what George Akerlof is talking about in his Market for Lemons article. The seller may have a lot of information about the nature of the commodity or the service, whatever, that they're providing, and that they might know that there's a problem, but the consumer doesn't. And so information asymmetry addresses is a rationale that we can use for economic justification for the regulation. Transactions costs are important because sometimes it's actually industry that comes to us and says, hey, like for instance, the National Organic Program, initiated by the industry because for many years, there was no control over selling organic produce or organic food, and just anybody calling it organic. And the transactions cost for the industry to actually organize something that to certify that something is organic, those transactions cost for the industry itself would be too huge. And so they came to the government and they said, will you please set up a certification program for us? Now, OMB also, in theory, they allow some non-economic justifications. My experience has been, although it's been pretty limited, my experience is really the non-economic justification that they accept is, hey, this bill got, bill got passed and the rule has been made. they don't really accept things like social rationales and stuff like that. So it's very limited and it's very neoclassical. So benefit cost analysis. Benefits are really basically, according to the justifications that you use and the way you set this up, the benefits are going to be the value of what we gain from resolving the market failure that is addressed in the rule. What they want is everything to be quantified as much as possible. But the problem is that, economic phenomena, well, a lot of benefits are very hard to determine. We're talking about things like, okay, we can estimate the value of life and stuff, but, there's a lot of issues involved with that. There can be a lot of uncertainties, and there can be a lot of things that we don't really know for sure exactly how it's going to happen, how it's going to play out. Costs are easier to figure out. But the problem is this, this puts the regulating agency at a disadvantage in preparing these things because, you're always trying to figure out what can we quantify the costs, quantify the benefits. And in a lot of instances, you can't quantify any of them. And so then what happens is you have to make a really good argument for it based, from the previous slide. Then your economic justification has to be pretty good, okay? All right, so, some of this is typical issues with benefit cost analysis. Benefits, a lot of times, are more experienced the cost may be up front, and the benefits may be experienced over time. And so they tend to look at a longer time horizon. Regulatory flexibility analysis, again, as I said, it is about considering small businesses and if there's an undue burden. One problem I see with this is that we have to use the SBA definition, Small Business Administration definition of small businesses. And it's kind of strange because, it changes over time. And so if when we have inflation, so over time, if you base the business on the size, on the amount of revenue you take in, well, then that's going to have to be adjusted, right? That makes sense. But not all the industries are determined, the sizes were determined on revenues for not all industries. It's not determined by revenue for some of the industries, mainly manufacturing. And so with manufacturing, it is based on the number of employees. Well, if you think about technology and how technology is changing, it's kind of weird because, you can have an industry that's growing and very big, but, it's just not employing all that many employees. Doesn't have all that many employees. And so sometimes you end up with these industry definitions that basically everything is classified practically as a small business. So so that's kind of a problem because OMB will look at that. They will look at the impact on small business, if everything's in small business. A lot of times they'll say, with small businesses, you need to make special accommodation for this, or you need to be able to exempt some of these people, or something like that. So, so there's some complications in that. Okay. Now, Green New Deal and jobs. Well, we heard some estimates yesterday of what it might cost. The cost might be. So we know for sure that it's going to, either one of those is going to exceed $100 million in annual impact on the public economy, right? And so Green New Deal and Jobs Guarantee are definitely going to be, we can get a law passed that authorizes them. They're going to immediately be considered as significant work. Significant drugs. And so it's going to have to go through all this process. Okay? And so we know that the costs are going to be high. But one thing that's good about, I think, especially about the Green New Deal and the Jobs Guarantee is there's actually a lot of information that we could use to better estimate benefits. So I think we could, I don't know that it would necessarily, the benefits would necessarily offset the costs. At least according to this kind of stuff that OMB accepts. But at least it'll be probably better than in some places. But it's still going to be a very controversial rule. It's still going to be something that has a huge impact. And so it's still going to be something that is going to get flagged by OMB. They're going to look at it and they're going to review it. And the other thing is there'll be a lot of uncertainty with it, and so that'll make it harder to do the analysis, basically harder to get the analysis accepted by OMB. And there won't be stakeholder input. So you know that all of the industries that have any impact on this will be talking to OMB and whatever agency is actually implementing this. And the regulatory flex will be a factor because small businesses will be impacted. Okay. The reason why I'm talking about this is not to say, this is never going to happen because we need OMB rules. It is, I'm talking about this to give you an idea of kind of what happens after it becomes a law and, where there might be some hang-ups so that we can kind of prepare for it and, try to consider that when legislation is being developed and also think about ways that we might be able to maybe be involved in maybe even trying to change some of this stuff again. Okay, so as I said, OMB, focus on the regulatory impact analysis is very strong, and it's institutionalized.
And what I mean by that is, this is just an executive order. So it seems like it might be simple, okay, well, we just issue another executive order. But this is something that's, these processes have been baked into systems for grading. And we have a whole industry of companies that do benefit cost analysis contracting for the government. You have a whole generation of economists that have, developed regulations with this methodology. And so it's not gonna, I don't think it's gonna be a real simple thing that we just, elect Bernie and then he'll just get rid of the executive order. There may be, I don't know, but and I think an administrative lawyer might be able to say more than I could. But what I'm trying to say is that I think it's institutionalized, and I think there will be a lot of pushback if we try to get rid of the executive order and try to get rid of this process. That doesn't mean that it can't be done, but I think it's something for activists to be very aware of. Okay, and then another point that I'm trying that I think we need to think about is this whole attitude of benefit cost analysis has actually not just affected the rule development process, but it's actually kind of expanded. And so what you see, being a person who's been working in the federal government for 20 years, what you see is there's an increased emphasis on evaluating programs. And what this means is that whatever programs are implementing this particular regulation, over time, OMB will want to say, see, okay, is this being effective? And what's difficult about this is OMB determines what the criteria is for effectiveness. And what I've had in my professional experience is that some parties focus on this and some parties don't. But overall, this whole process is being supported more and more by both parties. And so I'm basically saying I think this is a mindset that has been setting in, and it's the trend for it is to just make it, have corrective keep going and expand. And so that's the trend. So as activists, I think it's important to think about, okay, what are these things involved? And what are these things involved? And how might we be able to be a part of this? Or how might we be able to be, make some changes. At least acknowledge that they're there. One thing I wanted to say is rulemaking processes is piecemeal because it only deals with one rule. Okay, and one of the things that's also important to keep in mind is the rules are trying to accomplish something. What it's trying to accomplish might actually be somewhat limited by other things, other policy programs, other policies that we currently pursue. And for me, one of the things that's most important is air I trust, because air I trust has really influenced all aspects of the economy. And so when the oil industry is consolidated, the communications industry is consolidated, all these things are consolidated. And so that makes it harder for activists, or it makes it harder for consumers to have a voice. And this antitrust policy is actually not a result of regulatory changes. It's a result of changes in the way the program, the antitrust laws are implemented at the DOJ and the FTC. So, basically what happened was Robert Bork wrote a book called The Antitrust Paradox in, I think the 70s. And he basically said, hey, our antitrust
paradigm is wrong. We need to be focusing more on consumers. And so what that did was that was influential enough that it affected how DOJ actually approaches mergers. And so when they look at mergers, they, instead of looking as much at competition as they used to, they tend to look, they also look at the consumer side and say, well, you know, hey, this merger will, you know, could lower costs. Well, it could, but there's never any evaluation of whether it did. And so antitrust policy is just one example of something that you gotta think about, because you get a rule, you know, you can't get a law and you get a rule going through, but you want to make sure that it's not being like countered and negated by some other aspect of government policy. And so I think that's important. So anyway, what can we do? I think understand the OMB, its significance, what it does, understand what the process is. And that, remember that this is administrative law. So, you know, you get a law passed, that's statutory law. But now, when you're trying to actually implement it, it goes through the OMB into the agencies, and it becomes a regulation, which is administrative law. And that's where a lot of the detail is. And, you know, with OMB influencing it, basically it could end up being implemented maybe quite not the way we wanted it to be implemented. Okay? Also, participate, I think activists should participate in the regulatory process. And they do. They do. You know, just it may need to be more, but you know, and also, you know, be aware of what's going on with the industry, what they're doing. I think it's important maybe for activists to think about changing the process. Economists have a big role in this, and so they have a real vested interest in it. And the problem, as I said before, is that the benefit-cost analysis that's being used is strictly neoclassical. And the people, you know, the people who work at OMB, they are really seriously neoclassical economists. So even the basic institutional stuff, they don't like. So you know, you're really limited. But if the economics profession could be more opened up more, and there could be more, or at least the administration be aware of it, there might be a way to, it would be good if you could get some other approaches in developing these regulations. Then finally, see the big picture. As I said, sometimes regulations can be, maybe they end up maybe being somewhat undermined or not implemented the way quite we want because, there's other policies. Also, an administration can affect how quickly the rule goes through. So OMB might necessarily stop a rule, but it might slow it way down. And you know, with the Green New Deal, we don't have years and years and years for these different regulations, for the economic analysis to be done, and then look at different agencies and all the different things that go on in this process. Anyway, I just wanted to let people know about this process, and just kind of be aware that this is an issue that, you know, I think we want to keep in mind, because the development doesn't stop after you get a law passed. Then it goes into the bowels of the bureaucracy. And you want to make sure that when it comes out, that it is exactly what you want.
Right now we have time for exactly two questions for Sherry. So I'm going to pick somebody who has not spoken. Yes. Can you hold on 1 second? And I'm just curious, like, okay, one more question after this.
Hi, I love your presentation as an activist. I have a question for you about these policies. We always see editors who are bringing their own economists studies to argue their case from their perspective.
I'm sorry, I couldn't hear that last part.
So as an activist, I was particularly interested in your thoughts on how to change the game. We have a policy. We always have them each side bring their own economists and their own studies to argue their case. Typically, we look for the CEO to give us some indication of what they agree. So as an advocate for human capital and human Medicare for all, what would you suggest that we as a public or our activism do to maybe change this and get these processes involved a little bit sooner before we finalize the legislation?
I think a lot of the tool be is who you vote for, because if you vote for somebody who's really determined to get these processes, they will, you know, they will put a lot of emphasis on. That's one thing. And of course also we vote for Congress as well. The other thing is when there's a public comment period, make sure that people may not seem this way, but actually every single comment is read. Every single comment is addressed. We just aren't necessarily done individually. But what they will do is they will read the comments and sort of put it in a pile. Okay, this goes under this, that goes under that, and then it's a group answer. But make sure that you can get involved with that, I think probably activists as a group, I wouldn't be afraid of going to the agency itself, when the rule is being made, just so you can make it, you can make your case and make sure that the people who are developing the rule actually hear what you had to say. You can't help them make the regulation, and they can't tell you what's going to be in the regulation. But you can get your voice out, and you may bring up a point, or there might be maybe data that you can even offer that they're unaware of. So I think being aware, watching the process, don't just assume that after a bill is passed that it's going to be what you want. And in terms of speed, I think the thing is that's going to probably be really the public demanding that this thing goes through, because it can take years. Just don't let it.
Any other questions? One more question we have time for, how about, is there a way people can contact you if they have more questions?
Let's see. Probably the best way might be my personal email, which is wise.sherryj@gmail.com.
Thank you very much, Sherry, and thank you for everyone who gave a presentation this morning. And I guess now Jeff Epstein, who's not bad at Epstein, is going to be presenting.
Thank you for the wonderful introductions.
Okay, so,
okay.
Jeff, you good? Are you? Yes? So first, before I get started, I would like to bring in a special guest. Christine, can you hear us? Can you hear me?
I can hear something happening over there, not so clearly.
Okay, so how do we do this so he can hear me more clearly? Like, maybe I can...
I can see some people.
Listening to this, but I wish I was there, and I'd like to say to the core MMT writers and academics, Warren and Bill and Stephanie and Pavlina and Randy and Scott Hallweiler and Matt Forstatter, thank you, and sorry for anybody I've left out of this, thank you for this fantastic body of work that's really changing the world right now, and to anybody there who is working on spreading the MMT message and insights, thank you. Your work is saving lives, and because my day job is I do comedy shows with music in them. When you're a hammer, every problem looks like a nail. So what I did was I tried to write a parody song, a parody rock song about MMT. So I did that, and many of the people that I told, I was like, hey, I've written a parody rock song about MMT. A lot of people reacted like I just said, hey, I've just invented a trifle made of oysters. And which, you know, that's probably how paella got invented. But so I'm hoping that, you know, you guys at least there will get this. And please get in touch with me. I'm on Twitter. My handle is at MMT Podcast. Always love to talk to MMTers. And have a great conference. And I really hope this song serves as a half decent warm up to the excellent Jeff Epstein's Bohemian Rhapsody of an MMT song. Okay, thank you.
All right, so here's the song. While it's loading, I'll just say what I was going to say, which is,
someone's got you a star.
So when we saw that article in March, I wrote this song and it actually kept me occupied during a terrible job. It's from the 1879 Gilbert and Sullivan show, Pies and Penzance, and a very model of the modern age in general is basically the 1800s version of rap, as I see it. So I wrote it 24 hours after I wrote it, my then nine-year-old son memorized the most complicated part, and I'm really proud that he's part of it, but that part. And I sent it to Christian in private and shared it with him. And he immediately shared back with me that song, which no one knew about at the time. I didn't know about it at the time. So we coincidentally were inspired around the same time to do this. And then I got together with a local choir near me, who I'm now part of, called the Rancocas Valley Singers. They're amazing, as you will hear. And so here is my song. And after words, I'll put Christian on screen.
Bye. party, but it's very different as you'll see. They're franchised by the government, but what they make is not debt free. If you don't pay them back, your life will be infinite misery. It's a private debt, if it's not met, it just keeps growing big.
The role of the federal job is to government profits and perform automatic macroeconomic stabilizing prices and wages. Wages in the government are from the employee to even out the business cycle, thereby confirming the majority of inflation. Accent.
The very model of a modern monetary theory by both the Mitchell, Rainbow, Weiler, and Captain Stephanie. The federal job guarantee is a product commanded, but otherwise it just describes us all that is intended.
The federal job guarantee is a product commanded, but otherwise it just describes us all that is intended.
So we only have a couple, thank you. So we only have a couple minutes, I'm just going to bring you on screen just to say hello for a brief moment, and then we need to move on. Okay, Christian? Christian, we can only basically just say a quick hello, and we have to move on, unfortunately, with time, but really,
the BRB says America's news outlets no longer provide the truth. I'm Joshua Phillip, senior investigative reporter at the Epoch Times.
Yeah. Okay, Christian, can you hear?
I can hear you, yeah.
Okay, so basically we just have a moment to say hello to the crowd. There's something new, things and questions, but unfortunately we don't have the time to do that. So if you have any final words, lay it on us.
Yes, I think this was a great conversation. This was a great conversation.
Okay, say bye, everybody. Christian.
Bye.
All right, thanks for being with us, virtually. Thanks, everybody.
Jeff, thanks for this, Jeff.
Then,
okay. No, you have.